Welcome to Questions for Christians, where I, as an atheist, have an interesting and intellectual discussion with Christians in leadership. Today, my guest is Phil Smith, a philosophy professor at George Fox University. Welcome to the show, Phil.
Thank you.
Okay, so my name is Bernie Dehler, and I'll give a brief introduction to who I am, and then I'll give some time for Phil to explain who he is to you guys, our viewers. I was raised as a Roman Catholic. I became born again after getting a bachelor's degree in electronics engineering technology in 1984. I've been working in the computer chip design business since 1984. I went to seminary part-time. I earned a master's in ministry degree from Lutherite Seminary in Lithuania, Georgia in 2007. I once founded a ministry to preach the gospel on the internet and cable access TV. In 2009, I left the faith after 25 years as a born-again evangelical Christian. I wrote a booklet called Modern Science and Philosophy Destroy Christian Theology. For me, that's true. That's how I left my faith, was because of modern science and philosophy. And I wrote the booklet to help explain to other people why I left the faith and also to remind myself why I left the faith. And since then, I've done numerous local debates and discussions with Christians. And one of them is Phil Smith. We've done a couple local ones in the Portland area, and they're available on YouTube at my YouTube channel. And I want to also say that if some people say, when some Christians say they had this felt relationship with Jesus, I also felt that I had that, but I now consider it to be a God delusion. And so now I'd like to give Phil some time to introduce yourself. Can you introduce yourself to people who have never heard of you before?
Okay, sure. I grew up like Bernie in a Christian family. This one was a evangelical Quaker family. Became a Christian as a young person, just as normal as anything else. Later I went to college, began taking philosophy classes, had to struggle a great deal with my faith because philosophy raises questions. That's what philosophy is about. Later I went to seminary, did a master's degree, pastored some churches for a couple years. Went to the University of Oregon and did a Ph.D. in philosophy. Ethical theory is my specialty. And so in the years since then, I've written books in ethical theory. Why Faith is a Virtue is the more recent one, and we might talk about that. My first book, other than my dissertation, was called The Virtue of Civility and the Practice of Politics. I'm now writing a book on the virtue of hope that's coming out in bits and pieces as I work through the problems. And we may have some discussion of hope come up in some of the questions that we'll deal with later. Besides philosophy books, and there are others there, taken to writing novels. I wrote a fantasy adventure story called The Heart of the Sea, which is not full of all kinds of marvelous magic. I try to write stories with just a little bit of magic. And this is an ebook that you can buy. Then I wrote a book called a murder mystery story called Buying the Bangkok Girl. And you can imagine what lies behind that. There are some truly evil people in Buying the Bangkok Girl.
Well, it's got girl in the title, so that might make it interesting.
No, it's the people who you have to buy her from. Mm-hmm. She's a slave.
But having girl in the title is a good way to get some interest there.
We'd hope. But you can make dozens of dollars selling novels. And my most recent novel is called Castles, and now I've ventured into science fiction, and this one is free. Anybody can go to my blog, storymeaning.blogspot.com, and read all of it if you want, and lots of other essays, some of which we will talk about, I hope, tonight, essays that I've written. Other than that, I teach philosophy, and I'm very interested in doing good philosophy. As a Christian, I think Christians ought to be enthusiastic about doing good intellectual work. That wasn't quite as long as it should have been.
Now, did you say you have a website and a blog?
No, the university has a website and I have a page on there. But no, my blog is where I hold myself to putting some new material up every week, which can be incredibly draining when you have to come up with an essay every week. And so that is storymeaning.blogspot.com. And it has the entire text of Castles, 174 short little chapters, and dozens of essays that I've written over the last 4 years. And I'm beginning to try out some of my hope essays, Some of them I write at professional philosophy conferences, but I'm working out some of the ideas right there in public. So anybody can write in and say, this is stupid, if they want to. That'd be good.
Okay. So are we ready to get into the program?
Sure, that's fine.
Okay. Well, we have five topics, and each one's about 10 minutes each. And so we'll start the timer here.
Okay.
It's kind of frustrating because we know we don't get very far. But, okay, so the first question is, why do you believe or not in spiritual bodies? And this is in reference to a line I pulled out of your blog. Just to quote you, you say, first, and this is of central importance, we will be raised from the dead. We will have spiritual bodies. So I'll let you set that up and then we'll have a chat
okay.
about that.
Okay, this comes in the context of what I mentioned. I'm working on the virtue of hope. Now, there's a great deal of material written by philosophers of all sorts, theists and non-theists alike, and I appreciate what I'm learning from them. But in this particular essay, I'm asking in particular about what is Christian hope? And so I'm just trying to be true to the scriptures. And so in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul says unequivocally that the Christian hope is rooted in the resurrection of the body. And then he uses this phrase that just drives people crazy, drives me crazy. What in the world is a spiritual body? Sometimes Christians have an idea that our hope is very Platonic, that you die and your soul flies away to be with Jesus. It's an amazing amount of Christians who believe this, when really it's just Plato and it's not Paul at all. Paul says that our hope is that we will be resurrected and we will have, then he has this phrase that I've already pointed out, spiritual bodies. Do I know what they are? No.
Nobody does.
Nobody does.
No Christian theologian does. They all disagree and argue.
Well, and good for them. When we don't know, we should argue about it. And we should admit that we don't know. Does that mean, for instance, does not knowing what a spiritual body is in detail, does that mean the doctrine is somehow unbelievable or it's confused or self-contradictory? If it was self-contradictory, then it would be unbelievable, but it's not.
But it seems like it's not only not in detail, it's kind of like the only thing that's in common is the actual word, spiritual body. I mean, because mm-hmm. once you define it, that's where everything goes off the rails.
Well, Paul doesn't define it either, and he's not a scientist, but he's giving, he gives metaphors and similes to, he says, of, for instance, of wheat, that the seed falls into the ground and dies, and what you get is different. It's a plant. All right. He says, there are different kinds of flesh, the flesh of birds and fish and everything. Okay, there are different kinds. His idea, the thing that he's trying to really get across, comes in the famous line that gets repeated over and over again in the Messiah, and we shall be changed, so that our spiritual body, in order, it would have to be me, but it would have to be changed. So that doesn't tell you what it is, but it gives you broad parameters inside of which the argument has to go.
That's one reason why I left the faith, though, is because I don't think it makes sense to even think of, when you say it would be me, there's so many ways to think that doesn't even make sense. Like, for example, a baby that's miscarried, so mm-hmm. it's not even born yet.
Yeah.
What is that baby in heaven? I mean, there's no such thing as a person because a person progresses through age. I mean, you know, and then the other side is, what about a senile old person?
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes
mm-hmm.
they say, well, you're not going to be senile in heaven. Well, then that wouldn't be you, because if you go back 20 years when you're prime of your life, you're a different person. You have different ideas and thoughts. So there is no you that's really
so
a person
now,
anyway.
How far are you going to take this idea that, you see, what you are denying is the idea that there's personal identity over time?
No, I think personal identity is just a model, a mental model of you make of yourself. Like, who am I as Bernie? I work here, I have a
uh-huh.
spouse,
uh-huh.
and that
uh-huh.
changes over time. There is no
if there is Bernie the same person who was before his, what shall we say, his deconversion?
No, I'm constantly changing.
You are constantly, you are not mm-hmm. the same person.
Yeah, my name stays the same.
Uh-huh.
But
so
my thoughts and everything are different.
Is it then unjust for us to punish people for the crimes they committed before they were converted? Now they are converted, they're not the same person.
Yeah, I believe people have consequences. Mm-hmm.
So it is just to punish, because it is the same mm-hmm. person, even though there's been radical change between them.
I think this might go in the equivocation where basically you use the same word to mean different things.
No, it isn't. We're talking about what does it mean to be the same person over time, and especially over wide gaps of time. Paul died in the first century, and we assume that it, you don't assume, uh-huh. Christians assume, I don't want to put words in your mouth, mm-hmm. That on Resurrection Day, Paul himself will be resurrected. Thousands of years, who knows, Resurrection Day could be 10,000 years from now. So there would be this tremendous gap of time, or at least from my perspective would be, mm-hmm. Between me dying and let's say 2035, let's give me some years, and the Resurrection Day a long time from now. And this is a real problem because many people, Christians and non-Christians alike, will say, that's impossible. There cannot, unless there is something that ties me here to me then, it's not the same me. It's a personal identity problem. So here's the problem. We still have 4 minutes. This is great. this is one of the things we do. Star Trek.
Sure.
And you have the Star Trek crazy, it doesn't actually work physically, but the transportation.
Transporter room,
right. So invent something better than that. We have this little room over here.
Yeah.
You can walk in and the room will scan you mm-hmm. down to the atomic level.
Right.
And in order to scan you and reduce you to computer bits, ones and zeros, mm-hmm. it destroys you.
Right.
So there's nothing there. Mm-hmm. But on Mars, mm-hmm. they receive the microwave information. Mm-hmm. And on Mars, they have a machine with a good supply of hydrogen and oxygen and a few trace minerals.
Right.
And they use this information to reconstruct you after a span of 2 seconds.
Right.
Would you walk into the machine?
Yeah, I mean, that exact thought experiment is in the book.
Oh, it's big in the literature.
Have you heard of the philosophy book? It's got a lot of philosophical thought stories in it. I think it's called The Duck That Won the Lottery. Have you heard of that?
No, I haven't heard this. But the idea is common.
Yeah.
There's lots of it.
Right.
So would you walk into the machine? See how it relates to the philosophical problem. Does the Bernie who walks in here and is destroyed, is he the same person who walks out of the machine on Mars 2 seconds later?
Actually, I think we're like destroyed every second. I mean, I'm always... The Bernie that was here 5 minutes ago is gone now.
Uh-huh. Is there personal identity? Is the Bernie that you are now... Mm-hmm. You're in love with the young man who was learning to run this machine.
Just to be clear here.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'm not accusing you of anything like that.
Yeah, okay.
No. So you have a love relationship with a person, and time goes by. Are you still in love with that person? Or is it you? Who is in love with that person? Just the person who was there 5 minutes ago, or the you now?
Yeah, but see... When you say me, that's still my mental image of who I am. Uh-huh. I have a mental image of myself, and I have a mental image of you.
Uh-huh.
You are who I made a mental image of you. I mean, there's Phil. You have a different you because mm-hmm. you think of yourself differently. Everybody thinks of you a little differently. Well,
but you see how personal identity doesn't just function in Christian hope. It functions in science fiction analogy. Would it be the real you that gets out over there?
That's a good question.
And it functions in our legal system because we punish one another for what we did a long time ago.
Yeah, but and also the punishments vary depending on what you know. For example, if somebody lies, are they really guilty of lying if they don't know any better? For example, if somebody killed somebody accidentally, it's different than killing somebody on purpose.
Of course, we have different levels of responsibility for wrongdoing.
And if somebody's retarded, you don't hold them to the same accountability as you do somebody who's, very smart.
So now, Fred commits a crime. He is fully in command of his faculties. And he just wants money. So he defrauds his neighbors and makes millions of dollars. Mm-hmm. And he's caught at it mm-hmm. and convicted and goes mm-hmm. to prison. Mm-hmm. In prison, one of the people who he defrauded, who hates him very much, bashes him over the head. And Fred suffers a terrible brain injury.
Mm-hmm.
He can't remember anything.
Mm-hmm.
He's not able. He'll never commit fraud again because he's too stupid.
Right.
Is it right for us to keep Fred in prison?
I would say at that point, what's the point of having him in prison if he's not going to,
Right.
If he's for sure not going to do it again and he doesn't remember it and all
okay,
that?
Okay.
He's a different person now.
He's
right?
a different person, so he's not guilty anymore.
It's just like, what's the point of? What's the point of putting him in prison to
those are two different questions.
Him.
The justification of prison is a different question than whether he's guilty or not.
Yeah, I mean, he's still guilty, but...
Because he's the same person.
But the question is, what do you do about it?
We've pushed to the end. Okay, that was a good question. This is fun.
You're the first guest I've ever had that was able to watch the clock. That's nice.
Well, this
usually I'm trying to say, like, we're out of time.
We're having fun. Tune in.
Yeah, I know it's frustrating because we seem like we don't really accomplish anything, but at least we're starting the topics, I guess.
Yeah.
Okay,
so we're inviting people into intellectual work. Yeah. That's what we're doing.
Okay, so next question. This has to do with morality and driverless cars. You made a post about these automatic driving cars. And one thing that I wanted to bring up is that I think it's interesting because in a lot of atheist Christian debates, they talk about morality. And I personally believe that because of evolution, we're going to get into a machine life. I mean, Christians like to say, like, how do you explain biological life? There was a time where there was no life whatsoever. And I believe that life emerged from non-life. And in the same way that we have biological life, it's going to someday go into artificial intelligence. Mm-hmm. So I think machine life is a natural part of evolution. And I think it's fascinating, too, that they can figure out morality without appeal to God. I'll give you a chance to kind of set up this blog post or what your ideas are on this, but I just want to say I think it's interesting how cars and machine life basically has to make moral decisions. For example, if let's say a car is going 60 miles per hour, the Google car, and it faces a decision. Either I got to mow down 30 people because of this all of a sudden was an unexpected event here, or I'll go off to the side of the road and maybe hit 3 people. So 3 versus 30. I think they need to make decisions like that. And with my moral philosophy, largely based in consequentialism, it's not a big deal at all. But I think it's kind of interesting for people who believe in God because they feel like these moral rules have to come from the Bible. And I don't understand why so many Christians have a problem with understanding morality without appeal to God whatsoever.
Okay, there are multiple issues there, and we'll probably not get to the ones you really want to talk about. I wrote driverless cars as a joke for a fun event at our church called Story Slam. And then in the story, which is not really a story, I say, there will come a day when it's illegal to drive. And people go, oh, come on. And then I go through a little story, and it's all full of silliness about how we get to the stage where people don't get to drive anymore, and they'll arrest you if you do.
Now, because it's too dangerous.
Because it's too dangerous.
Right, yeah, because the automated cars are much safer.
Right. So the first stage is we allow there to be driverless cars. Driverless cars are being invented. I mean, there are major corporations spending much money
Apple,
on it.
Google.
They want to do this, yes. Yeah. So they will be allowed, and then there will come a time that somebody will make a dedicated, like the HOV lane. It'll be a dedicated highway just for driverless cars. And they'll be able to go faster and more efficiently, and they'll have fewer accidents. And then once that is done and it's demonstrated, there will come a time when some state somewhere will just say, look, human drivers have to drive only on their roads. All the other roads, the great majority of the roads, are for driverless cars. And then there will come a stage when they'll just say, let's give it up entirely. It's just stupid. It's just selfish stupidity for people to be driving. Let the driverless cars take over. And so eventually, driverless cars everywhere. Now.
And they probably have car races, too, where the driverless cars win.
Well, they might, but...
Because they already win at chess and Jeopardy now anyway.
I don't know about that. I think driverless car races would be incredibly boring. But...
Well, they'll skid around the corners and all that, too, just like the humans.
Well, we don't even have to wait for this. If you go to Safeco Field to watch one of the Mariner games, one of my favorite activities, I think it's during the sixth inning, they will play the stupid... hydroplane race on the video board. And it's just a computer thing, but thousands of people will stand there and cheer for the yellow, blue, and red. Well, that's completely off the topic.
Yeah.
The point of the driverless cars essay is that I expect, unless I die soon, to live into the period when the millions of jobs in America where people earn money by driving will disappear. And that led into my thinking about work and the future of work. Now, economists would point out that people have been inventing new ways of doing things for 10,000 years. And every time we come up with a new technology, it puts some people out of work and creates new jobs. Mm-hmm. That's true. But
in my case, I work in the computer field, and we do it because that's how we make money.
Right.
We have
right.
to sell computer chips that are more efficient.
But the point that I would make is there is a longstanding belief, and I argue that it's probably prevalent in virtually all cultures throughout human history up until the late 20th century. And that belief is that there is a moral goodness in working and a moral badness in being lazy and unproductive.
I don't know about that. I mean, I'd like to be independently wealthy.
We believe that now. But the thing is, often there have always been independently wealthy
mm-hmm,
people,
sure.
but they're a tiny percentage of the population. What we have now is a situation that capital has become so productive that a greater and greater part of the population is able to not work, and especially not work at producing the basic goods of life.
You know, washing machines and dryers and all that stuff is definitely a lot better.
Yeah, we like life a lot better with all the things that we make.
But it takes money to buy all that stuff. We have to have a job to buy it.
Do we?
How else do you get money?
Well, more and more people do not work. Think of the millions of people in America who have retired. We think it's completely normal for people to retire. Up until 1935.
But they did work, and
they worked at one time.
So we
fool ourselves by saying, oh, they did work, so they're obeying the moral law of work. The matter of fact is, they're spending a third of their life, or in some cases a half of their life, not working. The reason this is possible is that capital is so productive, it keeps producing more and more and more goods.
But you could also say that they put money into the system and now they're drawing it out.
Okay, now the economists will call the next group of people free riders. These are people at the other end of the economic spectrum. They, in any society, such as Western Europe or North America, where you have a safety net of social services, you will have some people who come to mm-hmm. the decision that they just prefer not to work. And so they'll live on, and so the economy calls them free riders. Mm-hmm. They're not producing, and they just live on
freeloaders, yeah.
Well, right. notice the moral condemnation in freeloader, right? There's the moral rule that all people ought to work. That rule has been with us. You know, it's expressed by, you know, in an American mythology.
But that's just a fairness thing. I mean, if people have to work for their survival, they would hold it against people who are surviving without working
and
for
that's
it. Like,
the
why
case,
should I work if this guy doesn't
That's
have
right.
It?
That's the case of John Smith in the Jamestown colony, right? In the American mythology of the beginning of our country, you've got these wealthy English, what do you say? What's the right word here? Not lords. But anyway, they don't want to work. They don't want to do physical labor. But the colony,
or something
something like that. The colony would have failed if John Smith hadn't, no relative of mine as far as I can tell. John Smith hadn't put in the rule, he that will not work will not eat. And so Jamestown is saved, right? That's our good old American moral value. We all ought to work. And it's not just an American value, it's worldwide.
Well, it's just common sense, it seems like.
You realize the power of capital to produce goods. In the future, my prediction is, in these four essays, capital will be so productive that, especially when you talk about working for necessities, food, mm-hmm. drink, clothing, housing, it will be a privilege to work, and most people won't work at that. Even today, there are lots of people who are making very good livings producing computer games. Has nothing to do with our needs. It has to do with what we have fun with.
I don't know. I don't know if some people are making a good living. I mean, there's maybe some business owners, but there's a lot of slave programmers, I think, and a lot of them probably go out of business too, trying to compete with each other.
And some people make money off of novels, and some of us don't.
Sure. Yeah, you know, like computer programs. Have you ever heard of Flappy Bird app?
No, never heard of it.
It kind of became a hit, and everybody started buying it, and the guy made a lot of money, but I think he said he programmed it in just like 60 hours or whatever, but then he removed it because he said it was... he thought too many people were being possessed by it or consumed by it. You know, that's all they were doing. I don't know. It doesn't make sense to me, but he made millions off it, I think.
I am not predicting that there's a future in which people won't work. People want to work because it helps fulfill their nature, I would say. And it makes for a better life.
Well, see, for
me, but they won't have to work.
Well, it depends. I mean, what I'm doing now is work because that's not something I'd really rather do. If I was independently wealthy, I would still be very active and you would call it work, but I wouldn't call it work because I love it. I mean, like I'd be doing shows like this.
Right.
That'd be my work, but it's not really work.
I'm intending to continue writing novels after I retire, even though there's, as I say, dozens of dollars in selling bad novels. So, you know, our time is up again.
Yeah.
Rats!
Okay. Next topic. Do zombies pose a problem for materialism? And this was on your blog, and you said, quote, "Rather, I think the zombie myth illustrates a troubling feature of materialism, a feature that some materialists have noted." So I guess I would be called a materialist. Personally, I don't like the word materialism because I think most people, they don't know what that means, and they think, first of all, they might think, well, you're a materialist is somebody that buys things a lot.
Yeah, like
you're
that's a consumerist materialist.
And Christians use that too, like, don't be so materialistic, you know?
Well, and that's a right thing to say for that particular problem. That's not what you're talking about.
Yeah, like somebody who buys iPhones and everything, they're a materialistic person. Basically, what you mean by materialism is somebody who's got a naturalistic mindset that says the material world is the only thing that exists. There's no supernatural world. And personally, I like the label philosophical naturalism or also metaphysical naturalist.
Sure,
It's the same thing.
You know, among philosophers, we use naturalism rather than materialism.
Because another problem I have with materialism as a label is that there's also energy. Like at the time of the Big Bang, there is no material whatsoever. There's not even a proton or a neutron, just energy
exactly.
only. And I believe in that.
A good naturalist is going to believe in gravity waves and all sorts of things that are not material.
Right. So I am a materialist, but I prefer philosophical naturalism.
Okay.
So now I'll let you outline why do zombies give a problem for my worldview.
Okay. First of all, this is just, again, a lot, mostly for fun, reflecting on people who enjoy, and there's a whole genre of this stuff over the last 100 years, zombie movies and zombie stories. Some of them are really wacko, like My boyfriend was a teenage zombie or something like that. I don't know, it was called My Boyfriend's Back.
Okay.
And for those of us who can remember the song from the 50s, this is hilarious, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
And by the way, just for the record, I'm not a zombie fan at all. And it's probably because I'm a materialist and not a zombie fan, so.
Well, and I'm not accusing materialism of an outright inconsistency. It's just a problem, and it's a problem that many materialists have themselves noted, or naturalists. And it goes this way. According to the zombie myth, which of course is just silliness, but something happens to make undead people, right? So people die and their bodies, there's not a resurrection, it's not the person anymore, because it's really clear in the zombie stories, the bodies are just walking around, right? Apparently they do nothing except seek other human beings to eat. Really boring, boring existence.
Except for it's good for a movie, if you're making an action movie.
People love to destroy these zombies.
People are saving their own skins, hiding from the zombies and all that.
Yeah, well, sure. So you have lots of tension about whether or not you can hide and survive. But from the point of view of the zombie, it's all fine flesh.
Right.
So in the zombie movies, first of all, they're very hard to kill, right?
By the way, right there. Personally, I think people might have liberty to redefine it. So in other words, if you wanted to make a new zombie movie, and these zombies also like to like exercise their brain, maybe they have chess tournaments.
You could
do that. You could take it. Write
a new
direction,
a person would, but the orthodox zombie movie.
Yeah.
The ones that are most common.
I agree with you.
The zombies are just a threat, and it's very hard to kill them. In Walking Dead, or what's the one that Will Smith was in? I Am Legend.
That doesn't make sense to me at all. I mean, like,
you can
blow off their arm; they're not dead. They still go after you. But if you blow off their head, somehow
apparently,
dead
if you kill
again.
Their brain, that kills them. Or if you burn them up, or something like that.
Okay.
So it's all craziness.
Yeah.
But as a moral philosopher, the interesting thing is in these stories. People have no compunction at all in killing, if they can, in killing zombies.
Survival,
justification,
self-defense.
But yeah, that's the reason for it.
Mm-hmm.
But notice how different that is. The way they treat zombies is different than the way we treat human beings?
I don't think so.
Oh, sure, it's very different. In
because like ISIS, if ISIS wants to kill us, we would fight back and kill them.
Yes, but if we did, now suppose that you're a just war person, you think that, you know, because pacifists would be even worse, but if you're a just war person and you think that it's right sometimes to kill other people, what happens as soon as the enemy soldier surrenders? You start treating them decently. You should not use mustard gas on them. Even Hitler believed.
But that's as long as they're not a threat anymore. Like the zombie, he's always a threat, even if you have a captive.
No, there are, if it is a human being, there are moral limits to what you do in warfare. The enemy needs to be treated as a human being with moral respect of at least some sort. But zombies, nothing at all. You can't, and this is why teenagers enjoy these movies so much. You slash them and burn them and whatever, and you just laugh at them because they have no moral standing at all. The person who believes that our real human enemy has no moral standing at all is a very frightening person. It'd be somebody like Bomber Harris in World War II.
But I don't know. I don't know if I agree with that, because if zombies could somehow be neutralized or whatever, I don't think people would say go out and kill them.
Well, that would be nice.
Like, for example, if there was a shot, you can shoot them at a distance with a tranquilizer dart, then they'd probably say, let's shoot them with tranquilizer darts, convert them, and then you no longer kill them. That would be immoral to kill them.
Well,
but the point is, the zombies are, you can't change them. They're just,
yeah,
they're
you
just
can't
hell-bent
change
on
them.
Killing you, and that's it.
And well, my thesis is that people treat them as subhuman. They treat them as non-human.
I think they just treat them as a threat.
Okay.
They're a threat to them.
Well, that destroys the that would be a good escape from the problem that I wanted to point to.
Okay.
The problem I wanted to point to is if you really, what the zombie myth illustrates is that we have something that the zombies don't. And whatever that something is, we respect it and we treat it morally as more important than zombies. Even our worst enemies, we think, we owe them, you know, when we put a person to death in capital punishment, we still treat him with respect. We follow and we defend his rights of as a defendant in court, and all the way through, we want to recognize, even if he doesn't recognize, he might be the most hateful person you can think of, and yet we recognize ourselves in him. Well, so the embarrassing thing, finally, after all this go around, for the naturalist is, what is it that we've got that zombies don't? Zombies are just walking human bodies, but they're not persons.
Yeah, I don't think that really, like I said, I think it's just the threat thing. I mean, for example, we also care about animals like chimps. We don't go around killing chimps just because they're not people.
That's right.
Even goldfish or whales or anything.
There are lots of things that have moral worth. Human beings, we tend to think, or at least most people do, have more moral worth than others. But it doesn't mean that other things don't have moral worth at all.
Yeah, I think that would extend to zombies if there was a way to take the killing.
Okay.
You know, take that. I mean, because they're basically just, they're out to get you. That's all they do.
Yeah, yeah. So maybe that's it. Maybe that human beings would regard zombies as moral beings, worthy of moral respect, if they weren't a threat.
Well, see, there's your book. There's your, you know, you like to do fiction books.
I don't want to do this.
You come up with a way to give the zombies a shot to where they're no longer a threat. Then there's a big Senate discussion on, should you kill these zombies or should we make a community for them? What do you do with these?
And there you go, I suppose. Yeah. Okay. That one wasn't a very good topic. We still have a minute left. Oh, well.
Okay.
Save it for something else.
Yeah, I'm sure we'll need it for something else. Well, just one more thing on that, too, is even if it was a problem for materialists, I was thinking a mythical story, it doesn't really cause much trouble because, I mean, what if you said, for example, we believe in Santa Claus and this creates a problem for materialists? It's like, well,
yeah,
how
I think
can a
that's
mythical thing have a
very
problem?
Good point. And the materialists who have worried about it have not worried about it because of zombies. The zombies is just an illustration.
Mm-hmm.
And the materialist worry is, and it's a fight among naturalists. One naturalist saying to the other, look, the view you have of human beings is really dehumanizing. You say that we're just a collection of, you know, neural impulses, but what about poetry? What about love? What about philosophy? Is it really reducible And the other side said, oh yeah, reductionism is cool, and there is no such thing as love or philosophy. And now you might think that I'm overstating it, but you need to look at eliminative materialism.
That sounds like another 10-minute subject.
Yeah, we don't want to go there.
That'll take at least 5 minutes to get through.
Way more.
Okay, so the next question is, why do you believe in the existence of God? And so I want to give 10 minutes to you to share your personal reasons, because I'm involved in a lot of Christian atheist debates, and you know, a lot of times, like William Lane Craig, for example, mm-hmm. he might say in an atheist or Christian atheist debate, I'll bring up these arguments, but that's not really the reason why I believe. I personally believe because I have a field relationship with Jesus and all that, but mm-hmm. in a debate, I have to give logical reasons, and so I give these reasons. So the question here is like, let's make it personal. Why do you?
Okay.
Why would you believe in God? Because I used to believe in God, and I don't believe in God. So why? What is your problem, Phil?
What is my problem?
Why do you still under this God delusion?
We need to make a distinction between two kinds of reasons, and you need to tell me which one I need to give you.
No, for you personally.
Yeah, they're both personal. They're both personal.
Okay, anything.
One is occurrent, and one is dispositional. The difference between occurrent and dispositional things.
Let me explain so you can ask. Okay.
I am said to love my wife. I really do love my wife. Mm-hmm. Do I feel love for my wife at all times? In fact, right now when we're arguing, do I feel love for my wife? No. When I'm asleep, do I feel love for my wife? No. It is not occurrent.
You don't remember until you wake up.
Well, some of my dreams I do. So an occurrent belief is what I'm believing or thinking right now. Mm-hmm. A dispositional belief. In this case,
would you
emotion.
Say current belief?
Occurrent.
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 Okay.
It's occurring.
Okay.
A dispositional belief is something that I am disposed to believe. And you have a dispositional belief that I can name in just a moment, and I will bring it up, and it will turn out that you do believe it. And that belief is Australia exists. Mm-hmm. See, now you believe it, whereas before you weren't even thinking about it.
I understand. Okay.
Okay. Okay. So, do you want my dispositional reasons for why I believe in God, or my current reasons?
Whatever is the most powerful to you personally. Like, if I said, "Stop being a Christian," and you're going to say, "Like, oh, I can't because I got such huge reasons for being a Christian. This is the top of my list."
Mm-hmm. Okay. Because God makes sense of the pattern of life. I've been reading.
I find that very curious, because that's the reason why I left the faith, is because mm-hmm. I think that an atheistic worldview makes more sense of the world than a theistic belief.
Okay. So you're trying to make sense of the pattern of life, and I'm making sense of the pattern of life. So you have to ask, what are the clues in the pattern of life that it makes sense of?
Yeah, so what could possibly make, what could, what, how could life possibly make sense?
Well, what you want, I would point to several different things. And the belief in God making sense of different things mm-hmm. gains strength from each one of them.
Okay, so like what's one, for example?
All right, the one that you mentioned before, belief in moral realism. How is it possible for people to have sincere moral beliefs and be wrong?
Okay, how is it possible for people to have sincere moral beliefs and be wrong?
Right. All I'm doing is I'm expressing moral realism in a backwards way. When something is real, you can be wrong about it. So sincere Nazis believed that it was their moral duty before God and Hitler, actually before Hitler, to kill Jews.
Well, I believe there is a Nazi.
They were wrong.
I believe there is a Nazi morality. I have my morality. Uh-huh. And I think my morality is superior to Nazi morality.
So we should call yours true and theirs false.
Of course. You call your morality true, you would uh-huh. call my morality false.
Uh-huh. Well, no, I don't know that at all. I don't know what your moral beliefs are.
Well, we're going to have some differences of opinions, and you're going to say yours is true and mine are false.
All right.
And there's another Christian over here. You're going to say he's got false morality and you got true morality.
We're just getting clear about what the realist believes. The realist says there are moral truths and people can be wrong about them.
Let me give you real quickly my idea of morality. Okay, I have a thought experiment or a way to explain this. It's just like a map. So, for example, I could say, how do I get to this studio from my house?
Mm-hmm.
I can go on Google Maps and it'll show a path there. Mm-hmm. And I think morality is the same way. You want to get to an end goal, which is community flourishing, and there's mm-hmm. a path there. Mm-hmm. Now that path may be blocked by an accident or something. There's an alternate path. Mm-hmm. So that would be the better alternate path, given all the situations. Mm-hmm. And so I think morality is the same thing. We have a goal we want to hit, community uh-huh. flourishing. And so what's the best way to get there?
What if people don't have the goal of community flourishing?
What other goal could there be for morality?
The goal would be the Aryan race should survive and all others be destroyed. That's
so,
one.
So they're talking about the flourishing of the Aryan race.
And others should be destroyed.
Right. So again, it's flourishing. And I would argue why I think it's better to have flourishing as a community than flourishing as the Aryan race. So at that point, we're asking the very fundamental question, what is morality all about?
That's exactly right.
Right.
The moral realist says there is moral truth and we can disagree about it. And we can be wrong. See, the great thing about it
but
is
you
would admit,
you
I'm sure.
Do you think there's a truth about what the best path here is to a moral ideal
very,
truth?
Very often in the details there isn't. Very often. Should I have worn this shirt or vest? Yeah. It has a nice black color. I could have worn my green one. There are all kinds of things I wear. They're morally indifferent, right?
It has nothing to do with morals, right? Because the color of your vest
right.
has nothing
to do with morals. Right, and the right way to get across town is morally indifferent. But the right way to treat your neighbor is not morally indifferent.
Right, because that's all about community flourishing.
Okay, so we're back to the basic point. There is a moral truth, and you can be wrong about it.
There is a moral truth.
Right. So somebody comes up and says, look, forget more community flourishing. There are people who just say, look, ethics is about getting what I want out of life. Hedonism. Hedonism is the moral truth. And this is Ayn Rand.
Right, right.
You have a duty to be selfish.
Right.
So, you who are looking out for your neighbor, you are being immoral,
right.
she says.
Yeah. So at that point, I wouldn't have a discussion about who has correct morals. I would have a discussion about what is morality? What does it mean to you? Let's define what morality is, because mm-hmm. we have different definitions of what morality is all about.
So you keep resisting the idea that a person can be wrong about morality. Now, the interesting thing is, most people
they're wrong according to my morality.
Well, sure. And of course,
let me give you an example. Let's say me and you are the kings, or let's say a whole community comes up with a certain morality, Nazi morality, for example.
Uh-huh.
If there's a Nazi morality, that's the morality. And if you do something wrong, you're immoral in that Nazi morality.
So now you've moved from moral realism to moral relativism. It really depends on the culture that you're in or whoever gets to make the rules.
Of course. You make your own morality rules. Another Christian makes their own morality rules. And you just end up okay. saying, well, yours are from God and his aren't. And he says the same thing
right,
about
now,
you.
So I'm just laying out the options here. Now, notice that you asked me why I believe in God. And I was mm-hmm. going to give you several different reasons that cohere around the pattern that coheres around the existence of God. We're not going to make it. But on this first one, what are the options when it comes on the question, how is it possible to be sincere and be wrong? Most philosophers, naturalists and supernaturalists as well, are moral realists. They will say there is moral truth, and some people are right about it, and some people are wrong about it. And if I am, it would be a joke for the naturalist to say, and by God, if I'm wrong, I want somebody to put me right. Help me out. Okay, so the moral realist says there is moral truth, and we want to find it. The moral relativist says there isn't moral truth.
Well, let me ask you a real simple question about that, just as an illustration. Is it wrong to lie?
I think it's wrong to lie most of the time. Most people do. It really is wrong to lie most of the time.
Okay, so is that subjective then? Since
no.
it's most of the time, it's not all the time.
No, it's not all the time. Does a moral truth have to be a universal rule with no exceptions? That's Immanuel Kant. I don't believe that.
So you're saying the morality is subjective?
No, I'm not at all.
It depends on the situation.
That doesn't mean it make it subjective.
Okay, so you don't think subjective means it depends on the situation?
No, it doesn't. Subjective means it varies okay. from person to person.
I understand what you're saying because I've heard William Lane Craig actually explain this because, I mean, a lot of Christians, do you agree with me that a lot of Christian people who talk about morality have that wrong idea that, we only have 50 seconds.
Yeah,
I feel
we
like
didn't
kind
even
of
get past
on
number
this.
One. In fact, we didn't get number one done.
Yeah, I mean, I heard William Lane Craig talk about it briefly. It's kind of the same thing you're saying where the morality depends on the situation, and yet whatever that is, that's an objective.
Well, like,
that's
suppose,
an objective.
Yes, I mean, most
thing.
Almost.
So it's kind of like a subjective objective thing.
All you have to do is be a soft universalist of any sort. Modesty is a virtue. How do you practice modesty in Saudi Arabia or in Santa Monica? Be very different in each. But modesty is still a virtue in both places.
Okay, so we're out of time on this one. So I guess to summarize your viewpoint, though, morality is one area of why you believe in God.
Right. God makes helps make sense okay. of morality as well as three That's or four other things I wanted to talk about.
Okay, interesting. Okay, so we'll go on to the next one here. Our next topic, let's see, this is our last topic. Is the gospel nonsense? This is an accusation I would like to make and then see mm-hmm. what your response is. Mm-hmm. So in my booklet, I wrote about this too. So basically, if you look at the gospel story, this is a way to phrase it. You would say this sounds silly or it's mocking it or whatever, but it's like factually true that you can say that God died on the cross to appease his own wrath. Because the Bible talks about actually Jesus' death on the cross was to appease God's wrath, and Jesus and God are supposed to be the same and all that. Mm-hmm. But so anyway, I think it's nonsense.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And even the whole reason why somebody has to die for your sin is ancient, and it seems like it's based in superstitious thinking about mm-hmm. killing an animal for your sin. Killing something pure for your sin.
Okay, so you've raised the issue that theologians call atonement.
Mm-hmm.
And Christians believe, among many other things, that Jesus' death atones for us.
Yeah, so the very idea of atonement, I think, is a super
okay,
superstitious.
Okay, and you have latched onto a certain theory of atonement that comes from the 12th century and said that's the one.
I would say every idea of atonement is kind of ridiculous.
All right, then what are the various theories of atonement that you think are ridiculous?
All of them. So you give me one that sounds reasonable.
Let's go historically.
Let's talk about that.
Now, what I would say is that each one of these theories has evidence for it in the New Testament. So that the real place, the Christians ought to just be, ought to admit that there are different possible theories of atonement. And
do any of them make sense, though?
Do any of them make sense?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I think more
I
than
think
one
I think the reason
do.
Why there's so many theories is partly because none of them make sense, and so they have to have another version of it.
Okay. The earliest, which came many centuries before the one that you've latched onto, is the simple ransom theory, that we're the prisoners of the devil and God frees us from him. Augustine loved it. The early church loved it.
Isn't that kind of funny? It's like, how did the devil get all this power to take something
this is
ransom?
Why, and this is why Anselm rebelled against the ransom theory. Anselm comes along in the 11th century and says, we've got to have a better theory because it's given too much respect, power to the devil, right?
So you don't like that theory?
That's what Anselm said. Actually, I think there's some truth in that theory. You ask anybody who's a victim of addiction whether he needs to be ransomed or not. Ask anybody who has felt the power of God to free me from addiction. Isn't that a kind of ransoming and freeing from the power of evil? I think there's a great deal of power in the ransom theory.
The ransom theory is you make a payment to somebody who's holding you hostage.
No, the main idea is that you get freedom from what's holding you hostage. That's right.
Right. And supposedly, so Satan is the hostage taker here, and he needs a payment, and God says, I'm going to make a payment, and that payment's going to be my blood.
Is the Satan part crucial to people who experience freedom from addictions?
It seems like it's nonsense on so many levels because Satan is a guy whose God is captive. Number one, he doesn't have any power. Number two, God's got to like make Satan a payment. That means like
okay. Now you're back to criticizing Anselm.
And what is his payment? It's his own self, his own blood.
Mm-hmm. Anselm's own theory is the theory of.
I mean, if you invented a computer and your computer went awry, you thought, okay, well, this computer's got another computer. Ransom. I'm gonna have to go kill myself in order to free this thing.
You suggested that they were all bad, and I've only mentioned one.
I know.
And a half.
Look, I mean, God is all powerful and everything.
Yeah.
Too.
Can we get to the others?
Okay.
Okay. Anselm's theory is the satisfaction theory. This is one that you've been ragging on all the time, so we don't have to say anything about it. That God satisfies His own honor But it's key that God can't satisfy his own honor. Man has to satisfy God's offended honor. And so Anselm in Latin, cur deus homo, why a God-man? And so he gives us this satisfaction theory to explain. You don't like it. I think it has some weaknesses,
yeah,
too.
I mean, even the God-man thing.
Okay. Then you come to the Protestants. Protestants finally come on the scene in the 16th century, and you get a penal substitution theory. And you'll find a lot of Protestants who are so into their penal substitution theory. That's what atonement really means. So that we have offended against God's law, and God as the righteous judge is going to punish us. That all makes sense. A while ago, you were thinking that we should punish certain people. But God also loves us. So can God let us off from what we have done? No, he just can't. It's got to be a sense of justice here. There's got to be justice. And so the penal substitution people, they say that Jesus, who really is one of us, pays the price for us. And so by faith in him, we can be saved. I suppose you don't like this one either.
God is all powerful. He made us. And mm-hmm. he's got to pay the price by sacrificing his own blood to appease himself.
Okay, so you don't like that one either. In the 20th century, we have the Jesus as our example, that Jesus, by overcome sin and borrows a little from the cessus free, by taking our place and dying and showing us how to live the perfectly moral life.
But that's not fair, though, because he's supposed to be God and man. He's got these abilities we don't have.
I don't understand. What
you know what? Like Jesus healed people. He actually, in the Bible story, he brings back a guy from death. So if he has all these special powers, maybe he didn't even feel the pain he had. How do you know he wasn't just faking it?
Well, I think there's good evidence. If
he could raise Lazarus from the dead, he could probably turn off his circuits so his brain doesn't feel any pain.
The Apostle Paul in Romans suggests what I think is yet another attempt at or a way of thinking about the atonement. And I call it peacemaking atonement. Now, you suspect me of being a Quaker and dragging this in because I'm a pacifist. Okay. Well, it's probably true. But I think it's also taught in Scripture. We are God's enemies. We are God's enemies in that we want to run our lives rather than letting him run our lives. So how does God deal with our enmity toward him? He comes to tell us, in spite of your enmity, I love you. We give him the finger repeatedly. And then he carries all the way through. All right, you can even kill me. We give him the finger. We're going to run our lives. We're going to run our world. And when we kill him, and it's very important to recognize that we killed Christ, not Pilate or somebody. Don't blame somebody else. One of the great sins of Christian history is blaming the Jews. When we killed Christ, we discovered that we lost. He defeated us. He overcomes us and makes peace with us, Paul says, by the cross. He redeems us to himself. Now,
and this was all God's plan before he created anything, before the foundation of the world.
Yeah, God was willing. Diogenes Allen, a philosopher who now is dead, makes the point that in loving us, the supreme act of love that we experience is when we recognize, and usually for brief instances, the true reality of another person. Most of the time, we think of other people as in orbit around us. Iris Murdoch says this is because she takes a Freudian view of human psychology. We are just driven by these unconscious desires, and it's just natural for us. Other people are just things in our lives, but every once in a while, we get this little sliver of recognition that other people are genuinely independent, they're genuinely real. Even in what we call the most intimate love relationships, it's not that often that we really see the other as they really are. And we love them. God sees us as we are, and he wills that we be separate, be truly independent, to be whole beings. Alan puts it, he is a center of being, and he wills that we be centers of being. And because of that, He relinquishes control. He lets us be what we want. He lets us kill him.
I mean, just the idea of killing God seems like it's a lot of nonsense there, too.
Okay.
Do you see the problem I'm having?
You're having a problem with the whole idea of the incarnation. And I have 25 seconds left. Yeah. I'm not going to try to defend the incarnation. But I do think it represents something deeply profound about God's nature, that he reaches out to us and will not stop reaching out to us even when we kill him.
I think it's interesting. I mean, when I was a Christian, I could have a... It's easier for me to believe it when I was also naive about other religions. But when you learn about other religions like Hinduism and all the other religions and all the other godmen and all this stuff, it's... Mm-hmm. I don't know. It's a different perspective.
Okay.
Okay, so out of time. Well, that's it. We got just a few minutes left in the show. Let's summarize a little bit. What did you learn today? What did I learn today?
Well, the first thing that we should learn, and this is something...
Make it personal. What about me and you? What
I would hope that we learn and that other people learn that philosophy is fun. This is fun. And it's also important.
Philosophy is love of learning.
Love of wisdom,
literally.
Supposedly.
Yeah,
supposedly. Unfortunately, in our academic world, often philosophy just becomes another way to make a buck and to get by.
And some of them are, I guess some of the philosophers were purposely vague too, or purposely hard to understand, but some of them were pretty awesome.
I'm a very old-fashioned romantic philosopher. I think we ought to pursue truth. We ought to try to say it as clearly as we can. And we're all limited. We don't know enough. And so it is a great thing when we run into people who disagree with us. Socrates and Laches. Socrates never was more than a basic grunt soldier, we would say. Laches was a general. But Socrates had the reputation for he was really brave, and showed great self-control. Having a discussion, what is courage? Okay, Laches is a general, Socrates is a veteran, they should know what courage is. Well, what is courage? Laches, well, it's what these young men are doing. Socrates, they're practicing with arms. Oh, really? But, can women be brave? Oh, yeah, but they don't ever practice with arms. Oh, yeah, it's a problem, isn't it? So, it's a typical, basic Socratic dialogue. They try out one definition, they criticize it. They try out another definition, they criticize it. At the end of this delightful little dialogue, Laches says, well, geez, Socrates, I thought I knew what courage was, but she seems to run away from me. Socrates says, me too, isn't it? Tell you what, come back tomorrow, we'll do it again. Let's keep trying.
Yeah, to me, courage sounds kind of boring, but we're almost out of time here. But okay. I mean, something I'd throw out there to for fuel for the fire.
Yeah.
I believe that philosophy should replace religion. Mm. And we don't have time to say that. But the reason why I say that is because I think philosophy is all about trying to understand the world with reason and logic. And one of the big problems with religion is it has to do with divine inspiration and what mm-hmm. they feel God has told them. But mm-hmm. We're out of our show today, out of time for our show. Thanks, Phil, for
being very much
on the show.
And mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, goodbye.
Yeah. Thanks for tuning in. So, Phil, what are your ideas on the atheists and the new atheism movement? We've got some famous ones and even a local one here in the Portland area.
Okay, I want to be careful here because it's easy for me to get and be mean or unfair. But when we talk about the new atheists, we're talking about Dawkins and Daniel Dennett and Sam Harris and, oh gosh, now I'm going to
Hitchens.
Christopher Hitchens.
The four horsemen of the apocalypse.
They are, what I call them, and I don't want to be too insulting, they're like you. They're evangelical atheists. They're out there to make us evangelical.
That's not insulting. Okay. That's fine. That's
just
I
descriptive.
I'm an evangelical atheist.
Yeah. Well, a lot of them would be
insulted
by the word.
Right. But,
so you're not. So right. You have deeper understanding.
Right, right.
Okay, so, well, I have to admit that my...
I'm going to quote you on that, by the way. I have deeper understanding, Phil Smith.
Well, that is over the meaning of the word evangelical. You weren't insulted by these people would be. I don't really mean to insult them, but that's true. They are evangelical atheists, right?
Yeah, I'll take it. I have deeper insight. Okay.
Okay. So, frankly, these guys are out there attacking religion with a lot of really bad arguments. There are some really good atheists out there, good thinking atheists out there. You know, historically, somebody like Bertrand Russell, or more recently, somebody like J.L. Mackey, or currently, like William Rao, or somebody like that. There are good atheists out there, do good philosophical work. But these four guys are not impressive at all, and they often use things that are just terrible non sequiturs. So I'm not impressed. Now, you mentioned Peter Boghossian, and I think in some ways Peter would like to become one of the four horsemen.
Why don't you explain who he is?
Well, he's a...
Because we're in the Portland,
he's
Oregon area.
He's a philosophy professor at Portland State, and famously or infamously, depending how you want to look at it, he has said publicly many times that faith is an intellectual sickness, right? So this is where I first became aware of Peter. And so I went down to one of his talks at Portland State, and then I wrote him an email after saying, oh, come on, Peter. And we jawed back and forth. So he invited me down, and we had a conversation together. And he found out that I was a serious philosopher. And this is when I was working on one of my books, Why Faith is a Virtue. I work in virtue theory in morals, and I was defending the idea that faith is a virtue, it's part of the good life.
Well, just one little interruption. I want to say a couple things. About the faith thing and Peter Boghossian, I read his book, but I can't remember exactly. But there's two things I want to bring up. One is that he says faith is a failed epistemology, which I think is a very good point and very strong, and I agree with strongly. Then he also said he has a definition of faith as faith is pretending to, what is it? Pretending to know what you know ain't true or something like that.
Well, this is...
Which I would disagree with.
He might have borrowed that from me, because...
Well, it was from Tom Sawyer or whatever.
Yes, it is from Tom Sawyer. I got it from... Or you can get the one from Lewis Carroll in Alice in Wonderland.
I just want to back up there. So some of the things I strongly agree with them and some I disagree. So then, carry on.
Peter invited me to come down and talk to his atheism. He has a very popular atheism class at Portland State. And he generously gave me an hour to talk through the main ideas of my book. And then we had another hour for students to pepper me with questions. That was lots of fun because none of the questions were friendly. Wasn't that great? It was a great experience. But Peter is very honest and very fair and respects good intellectual work. So when I finally published the book, I had to give him credit
Which book was this?
This is Why Faith is a Virtue.
Okay.
Now, he does not agree with what the book says, but he gave it a fair hearing. That's the way we should do our work, give fair hearings to things that we disagree with. Part of the book, I had to address this problem of what is faith, because there are many different, and so with a very little bit of work, I demonstrated there's at least seven different versions of what faith is in different, and some of them are this group of Christians and this group of Christians that disagree with each other, and then you have this group of critics and this group of believers. So the disagreements are all over the place. It's very complex. And then I offered my own definition of faith, and then the book is a book-length argument why that faith contributes to a good life. I suggest that faith is when you believe something that someone for whom you have intellectual respect does not believe. So, I have intellectual respect for Peter. I believe in God. Peter does not believe in God. I have respect for Peter. Immediately then, I have a good reason to doubt my faith, don't I? Whenever you run into somebody for whom you have intellectual respect and they don't believe what you believe, you have at least some reason to disbelieve what you believe. So,
I don't know. I don't really understand that too much. I mean, for example, I don't believe in God and you do, and
so you're going to say that
if you came up with a good argument, I would consider that. But I tend to think that I know where you're coming from, and I've already examined it. So the existence of
thoughtful, rational believers gives you no reason at all to doubt your position.
No, because I feel like I've already evaluated why they believe,
and
I've already
dismissed it. This is the problem that we find among many Christians who will allow no possible counter evidence to their beliefs.
No, I think I've already considered the counter evidence.
All of it?
I think so.
You have examined all possible counter evidence to your atheism.
Yeah, I think so. When you bring up news, and I'm open-minded. So if you say, here's something new, I would look at that. But like when you talk about...
But you've already just said you've examined all possible counter-evidence. I can't possibly bring anything new.
No, I'm not saying for sure I have.
Well, then let's re-examine the question. Have you examined all possible counter-evidence?
No.
Okay, that's better.
But do I think you're going to tell me anything new? No.
No, that's reasonable.
And if you want to tell me something new, I'm all ears and I'll consider it, but I just don't think you're going to tell me anything new.
Sure. It seems to me that the place where doubt actually occurs in our lives is when we believe a thing, and this applies across the board, not just to religious questions, scientific questions, social political questions. We believe a thing, other people whom we respect disagree with us about it. William Wilberforce believes in 1800 and before that slavery can be eliminated in the British Empire without disaster. Most politicians disagree with him. Respectable people, smart people. He continues to believe. I think he has, that's kind of faith that he had in this moral conclusion. In the 1920s, Alfred Wegener has a theory that the continents move. He is the world's first and, at that time, only mobilist. All the geologists, in fact, they organized world conferences in New York to ridicule him. They were the leading scientists of the day that said, no, we know about geology. This guy who is not even a geologist and is talking about paleontology and all that nonsense, he doesn't know anything, and he's got this weirdo theory that and by the way, he's made predictions that are way wrong, and he did make mistakes. But he believed in his theory. He had faith in a scientific theory against people who disagree.
Now, because of evidence in it, though, too,
and,
right?
And he would say, well, they had lots of evidence. Every scientific theory in the world has evidence for it and against it. There is no such thing as a scientific theory that mm-hmm. that covers all the evidence.
But that's not true with theology, though, I would say.
Well, it should be. We should have a lot more. We should have a lot more humility about our theological positions. We ought to be. I am certainly open to being wrong about lots
of things. Well, when Peter says that faith is a failed epistemology, do you agree with that? In other words, somebody says, like, I know God's real. Why? Because I just feel it.
I would say certain kinds of faith ought to be rejected, and I do. That is, when I go through the different kinds of faith, and these are ways that people actually use the word faith.
But as far as an epistemology, a way of knowing, would you agree that faith is a failed epistemology?
No, but you have defined it in a certain way that I would have to say, well, sure, that's a failed epistemology. Consider this.
Well, how could faith actually be an epistemology?
When you rely on what Polanyi called tacit knowledge in order to focus on the knowledge that you want to gain, both of those are kinds of faith. You rely on something that you cannot specify.
Background knowledge, basically?
Tacit knowledge. Some of it is background, and that is, you could specify it, but some of it is you could never specify it, and yet you rely on it.
Intuition, basically?
No, not intuition. It's something that you, sometimes it's very much that you have learned. We can go into this if we take another 10 minutes on it. And so there is a faith that you're relying on something, and there's another faith that there is something out there that I can learn to understand. The scientist, the person who is in the process of knowing, of coming to know, has to lunge out into the unknown with the confidence that it can be understood. And that is a kind of faith.
Yeah, I have no problem with that. I have no problem with saying scientists have faith in their hypothesis and they look to falsify it or confirm it.
Yeah, okay.
I know some atheists have a problem with that. I have no problem with that.
But, so there are some kinds of faith that work.
But the launching point is evidence. It rests on evidence. Uh-huh. They're saying because of the evidence, we want to launch out and do this. Mm-hmm. But as a way of knowing, faith as an epistemology, I can't understand an example of where that would be.
I just gave you one. Where you rely on things that you cannot even specify.
But that's not a way of knowing. You can't say, I know it's true because I feel it.
That's not what I'm saying. You rely, you depend, you believe in things that you can't even specify, mm-hmm. and on the basis of that, you seek more truth.
Right.
And you, when you achieve that truth, then you kind of move into it.
Right, right. But if somebody says, like, do you know that to be true? And they say, yes, I know it's the true. I know it's true because I have faith in it. That's,
well, that is a kind of faith that I'm not, that I'm, obviously I'm not talking about.
So isn't that the definition of a failed epistemology, where somebody says, I have faith, I know God exists. How do you know God exists? Because I have faith. So we would agree that's
a poor argument. You just say, because I have faith, mm-hmm. That's not an argument at all.
Exactly. Okay, yeah. So that's why faith is not a way of knowing anything.
Faith is an integral, unavoidable part of the way of knowing in all science. I would go that strong.
Yeah, I agree there is faith in science, and okay. I would argue with a bunch of atheists. I know a bunch of atheists who say, like, oh, faith has no place, but I mean, it is passion-driven. You need to be driven by passion, and you put your faith in the evidence, I would say. Mm-hmm. So, okay.
Did I get to, I did say about Peter that I respect him, didn't we? We wanted to get that in.
Okay. 1 minute just to finish up this section. So how do you want to tie this all together with Dawkins and Peter and all that?
Well, there is a great, just because a person is a theist or just because a person is an atheist, you cannot tell whether or not he's doing good philosophical work. All right?
Okay. How do you think Peter Boghossian fits in with the Four Horsemen? Is he like...
Well, he is an evangelical atheist. Yeah. He's enthusiastic for it.
Do you think he'd be a good replacement for Hitchens if they're looking for a
horseman? Better replacement, because he would at least avoid what I see as one of the blatant, obvious, and right out front errors, just gross errors, of somebody like Sam Harris, who says, look, you can't argue with theists, just ridicule them.
So you think...
Peter wouldn't do that.
Do you think Boghossian would be the top... Of the Four Horsemen, of those?
Oh, that doesn't, does that mean, no, Daniel Dennett is a real philosopher, and he's pretty good. He should know better, but he's pretty good.
Not saying Peter's not a real philosopher.
Oh, of course, Peter is a real philosopher.
Philosophy,
he teaches philosophy, he's a real philosopher, he's serious about it, yeah. He's good.
He has a PhD in education, not philosophy, but he teaches philosophy.
Yeah. But you don't need to have a degree to be a philosopher, you need to do good work.
Okay. Okay, so we talked about why do you personally believe in God mm-hmm. and Jesus and all that.
And we didn't get very far.
Yeah, but you did bring up morality, that you think morality makes more sense from a Christian viewpoint than an atheist viewpoint, for example.
And we didn't even get into the details.
Okay. So you know, you're saying you have like three other reasons?
There are other reasons, yeah. Let's see, what did I put down? Second thing is the Big Bang. And the first thing, the question then is, what caused the Big Bang? Mm-hmm. The first thing to notice about this is that it is completely separate from the question of morality. There are just two different philosophical problems.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, science.
So that if you find an answer to both of them that is the same answer, the fact that your one answer solves both problems strengthens your argument. Now,
well,
I've heard you sometimes...
Well, I would say the morality is a philosophical question, and where did the Big Bang come from is a scientific question.
Is it a scientific question? The science said, well, we first learned about the Big Bang, you know, less than 100 years ago. And so the Big Bang...
And it's our modern creation myth.
It's our modern creation myth.
Myth meaning that we don't know what's absolutely true. It's the best
but
model we have so far.
It organizes a lot of other theories, mm-hmm. right?
So
it
that's is the best we have so far.
It functions as a myth, but it is the best we can do. But what all scientists naturally want to ask is what caused it? Yeah, what caused the Big Bang? Mm-hmm. We run into a big problem. Because according to the Big Bang, and Einsteinian views of physics, space-time starts at the Big Bang.
I don't know if that's true or not. I don't know if there's a consensus on that.
All right, but for most people,
it sounds reasonable to me to say at least time starts there, because the infinite regress problem, that makes sense to me that time could start there.
Well, but what Einstein taught us is that time and space are not different things, they are one
right,
thing, space-time.
Right,
so
right.
Space-time
fabric,
starts at...
That's a good point.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right, so, but ordinarily we think of efficient causes as coming before. The efficient cause of this pen is I decided to move it up. That's kind of the cause of this interview is that you invited me to come, and that happened before it. Mm-hmm. It would be really weird to say the cause of this interview was something that happened next week.
But you heard that cause and effect, it looks like it's broken on the quantum level. Have you heard that, right?
We have all kinds, we have Here's another problem in philosophy of science. We have two major successful research programs, quantum dynamics and relativity, that clash. And we need to get a theory of everything. Mm-hmm. Hawking is sitting there in his chair, or whatever he does, working on it, trying to come up with it. It would be the holy grail of the 21st century to come up with some way to bring these two theories together. Mm-hmm. Intellectual problems are great. It's wonderful. We ought to try to solve them. Mm-hmm. All right. What causes the Big Bang? If we think in terms of ordinary...
Bottom line is nobody knows, right?
Nobody knows, but it's worse than that. If you think, unless
causation... How can it be worse than that? Okay.
Because you can't know unless causation is different than any form of causation we know. Efficient causation happens before the thing. So some people are saying, well, maybe the key to the cause of the Big Bang is math. String theory. Have you heard this one?
Mm-hmm.
It's one of the so that there's just something about string theory in math that causes the Big Bang. That is the current thing that we've come up with. What was the first thing that they came up with? As soon as we found out about the Big Bang, there was a very popular theory that was in all of the textbooks in the 1960s and 1970s, the oscillating universe theory. The universe explodes into being, expands and expands, and eventually it collapses on itself, and then it just does it again and again, so that you don't have to ask about the cause of the Big Bang because the universe is unitary.
There is no Big Bang in that theory.
Well, not in the sense of a first Big Bang. Unfortunately, I'm testifying to what I have read about and cannot possibly understand.
I mean, one way I understand it, the Big Bang is... they now can see all the planets or all the galaxies moving away from each other, except for the Andromeda galaxy, which we're actually on a collision course
with.
Oh,
really? Cool.
But most galaxies are expanding, and so they're saying, let's just rewind the tape. And
right.
That's why you get to a Big Bang.
That's where we have the idea that there was a Big Bang, which was very upsetting to naturalistic philosophers, because the typical naturalist position was that the universe has always been here. You don't have to have a big beginning, it just began. Mm-hmm. Well, it never began, it's always been here. Mm-hmm. The oscillating universe theory was a way to get around it, because instead of this universe being here all the time, you just had multiple series. Mm-hmm. But Hawking and Penrose, I'm told, I couldn't do the math, have said, no, doesn't work, the formula won't work out. This universe is a one-time shot. It began at a certain time, 13.7
billion
years ago.
And how it was birthed, nobody knows, right?
And you don't even get to ask, which is very frustrating.
Well, you could probably ask, but it's just way beyond our scientific abilities right
now.
Yeah,
but notice, if there is a personal God who loves us, who creates the universe, that gives an answer.
That's not an answer. That's just saying magic. It was done by magical beings.
All right, you can criticize what you want, but notice that the same answer gives real confidence in morality and real confidence.
But isn't that obvious? That's it. I mean, it's like...
No, it's not obvious at all. And I'm going to finish my list.
Where did humans come from?
It is not obvious at all, and I'm going to finish my list. The next one is what's called fine-tuning. When the Big Bang occurred, there are the four constants of the... I can't even remember them all. There's the strong force, the weak force, gravity, and...
Nuclear force, maybe?
The strong force and weak force are both nuclear forces.
Okay.
So there's one other I can't remember. Many physicists...
Magnetism? Or I don't know.
Physicists have pointed out that the four basic constants of the universe are in almost perfect alignment, and that is... You need to think of them all as having an almost infinite possibility or range of possibilities, and they all fall in a very narrow band so that we could get,
cosmological
stars.
Constants you're talking about?
The cosmological constants. The fine-tuning argument is there's a huge literature here. How is it that we got so lucky? Well, one way to answer this is multiple universes. There's been an infinite series of universes. Eventually, you got to have one that you get lucky in. But that doesn't happen because Hawking says we can't.
Hawking?
Because Hawking says that, as I said
before... Well, Hawking is not against multiverse,
I don't think. Multiverse, he's not. It's the oscillating universe theory.
Right.
Now, so the other option other than the oscillating universe theory is the multiverse theory. Mm-hmm. And so, and in its full-blown sense, it says, look, every time you have quantum indeterminacy, both universes come into being, so that you have an infinity of universes just created since we started having this conversation. All the possible quantum universes do exist. And so naturally, in most of them, there would not be life, but in a few of them, there is life.
I think that's a lot of detail. I think just more, it's easier just to say generically that our universe could have been birthed out of a multiverse and what that multiverse is. You know,
it's just as mis- no, no.
You don't need to multiply all these specific, things on there. But
what they usually do is they say all possible universes do exist, and naturally then, there's going to be a tiny minority of them. But of course, we would evolve in the tiny minority. So, it's problem solved. Mm-hmm. Except these unknown universes are just as mysterious and just as matter of faith, as much a matter of faith as believing in God.
Just because the science is so far out there, we don't have the ability for it.
You think that no, it's not that way.
If
they are multiverses, science explores this universe. It cannot explore universes outside of this one.
Well, some people have claimed that there's no way to test whether there's a multiverse out there, but some scientists have come up with creative things. Like, for example, mm-hmm. they say, if there is a multiverse, if that's really true, we might see in the background radiation. We might see
test for it.
Yeah, we might see some bruising, because we might be hitting another universe and it'll show some bruise marks or something.
Okay, okay.
And they've actually looked
for
those.
If it turns out to be a way of testing it, then that would be really cool. That would be good.
And that's very creative thinking, because, you know, mm-hmm. off the top of the head, some people said, well, there's no way to test it, therefore it's not science. But then they do think of ways.
We're down to about a minute. The last one is
for you personally, that's compelling.
The combination that God explains these very important questions, it is compelling.
I don't think it's explaining. I think it's just magic, appeal to magic. So, okay.
Why does evolution produce human beings that have reliable cognitive faculties?
Sometimes they aren't. Sometimes there's optical illusions and
that's
things.
That's right.
But we learn from science what those are and try to take those into account.
No, I think the only consistent answer is that evolution produces cognitive faculties that help us reproduce. That's all it does.
Yeah, sure.
And so if billions
of people... Survival of the fittest is part of that reproductive
right, but that's
thing.
That's the whole idea what they call natural selection. There is no purpose to it. It's just a selection. The selection is for whatever works. And intelligence for human beings has worked. Non-intelligence for bacteria has worked even better.
Well, it's not just humans. I mean, chimps and elephants, they migrate, mm-hmm. and chimps have warfare and tribal things. Mm-hmm. I mean, they all have to use some mm-hmm. intelligence, even for mating. There's mating dances.
Yeah,
and
so
stuff.
Intelligence, we think intelligence is really cool.
Mm-hmm. Animals do too. Like, even using deception, animals use deception.
All right.
Stuff.
Is there anything in intelligence that leads to truth? It leads to, so far, reproductive mm-hmm. success.
Yeah.
But
and warfare requires truth, because, you know, if you want to deceive your enemy, you need to know what the truth is. And if you want to develop nuclear technology mm-hmm. for nuclear bombs, that needs to be based in truth.
So 500 years from now, after we have used our bombs, and there are no intelligent beings on Earth.
You mean no chimps or anything? No whales
or
anything?
Yeah, well, if we use them, probably the best.
Back to bacteria again?
You know, bacteria or maybe cockroaches, they say. Okay. The cockroaches win the war.
Okay.
What should we say about evolution then?
That's just a setback. I mean, as far as we're concerned, but mm-hmm. life's always changing.
Life is always changing.
I mean, right now
changing.
It's evolving.
It's
life's
changing.
Evolving even right now
yes,
at this point.
It's always evolving. Mm-hmm. It's always changing, but not toward a goal.
Right. Right.
So the goal of evolution was not to create intelligence.
Right.
So the goal of evolution was just to get us to a position where we can reproduce our genes.
Dominate your niche or so, yeah. Mm-hmm. Like, we are the best at thinking, but we're not the best at flying or the best at swimming.
That's right. And so the best at thinking does not give us true beliefs. Look, most people on Earth believe in God. It must be a mistake.
But I think true beliefs are a matter of survival.
Are they?
Yeah, because when you go to war,
when it comes to religion, the real true belief,
if we go to war with China, like if we go to war with China or Russia, if we have the true beliefs, we can, you know, that's why we develop science and they try to weaponize all the science and everything right off the bat.
So, true beliefs are evolutionarily successful, mm-hmm, and that's why we get them.
I think so.
Then why do people get bad, false beliefs?
They're the ones who become food usually. The ones who have the false beliefs are the ones who people. You know, they use them to get what they want. If you're a dumb person, you'll work for less wage than what you deserve.
The point here is very straightforward.
You'll have to summarize. We're going to be out of time, so I'll give you a minute to summarize this.
Success in natural selection is success in reproduction. It is not success in gaining the truth. So we should not be, if you believe in evolution, which of course I do, and if you believe in naturalism, which of course you do, then you should have no confidence in your cognitive capacities, because they are not evolved for truth, they've evolved for success. Success is not truth.
Well, it's
just a different thing.
Well, survival though too.
No, the survival is survival of our genes.
We need the truth in order to survive in a war with China or Russia or anybody else.
We don't.
We do, because
if that's true, then why do the bacteria win?
They don't win.
They do win. No. If we have the war, they win, because they're going to still be here.
Well, right, there's bacteria in the body, and we develop pills to kill the bacteria. So
yeah, we try to kill them, but we lose all the time. The bacteria on Earth outweigh us. They don't just outnumber us, they outweigh us.
Someday, I believe, we're going to create the machine life and the robots, and they're going to be the dominant force, and we're going to be their little monkeys anyway.
All right. Well, we went way over time. Thank you for watching, if anybody's still there.
Okay, Phil. Thanks for being on the show. Really appreciate it.